handed over quite a number and voted with members to the council. I hope that you've enjoyed your time on this committee. It is a very interesting committee to be part of. It's a very important committee to be part of, and I hope you've been able to fully engage in the work of the committee and contribute towards the development of good and better services for health and social care on Wirral. I'd like to thank members of the previous committee for the work that they did, and particularly Councillor Julie McMullen, who was chair and who's now moved on to a cabinet role. And in fact, the agenda that we're working to tonight is the agenda that was set by that committee. Our future work programme will be developed in conjunction with the party spokespersons, and I hope that we can get on and do that fairly promptly after this first meeting's over. But the work programme, for those of you who are new to the committee, will consist of formal reports to committee, spotlight sessions, workshops, and hopefully a health and care panel which will feed into this committee. And if the need arises, we'll look in depth at some subjects which has been finished, which have proved very useful in promoting understanding of certain issues. I think it might be helpful, because there's so many new members, if we just go around and introduce ourselves so that we know who we are and you know who the officers are. If you're in need of any help or support, please don't hesitate to come to myself or Alex Davidson, who is our Scrutiny Support Officer. But I'm Councillor Moira McLaughlin, and I'm chair of the committee for this year.
Hello, I'm Jason Oxley, Assistant Director of Health and Care. I'm representing Graham Hodgkinson, Director of Care and Health today.
Cottier. Norbury.
It's Phil Gilchrist, lived down to Muspratt.
Councillor Alison, Wright.
Paul Hayes, Councillor for Wallasey.
Councillor Bruce Bowie.
Councillor Mary Jordan, Conservative spokesman.
Patrick Sebastian, no microphone, committee officer.
I think he's sure I'm head of legal services.
Thanks everybody, and we'll move on to the agenda program. Can I start with apologies for absence? We've had apologies from Graham Hodgkinson, the Director of Adult Social Services. I think he's on holiday, we gave him permission to do that, I don't know, but still, we've got Jason Oxley here, who's secretising for him today. Can I ask members if they have any declarations of interest? Councillor Gilchrist?
I'm currently the Governor of the CWP, nominated by Wirral Borough Council.
My son is a GP for the NHS. I work for the NHS at Crossbridge Cancer Centre, and I'm also the company secretary for injured babies and the NHS charity.
Sharon?
I was the assistant in the NHS in NHS organ transplant.
Christina?
Daughter who works for the NHS.
Tony?
Daughter works for the NHS.
And I also have a daughter who works for the NHS, but well represented on. And I also ask that members will reassure me that you've not been subjected to the part of work. Okay. Next item on the agenda is appointment. Next item on the agenda is the appointment of Vice Chair for the coming year, and I'd like to make a nomination of Councillor Phil Gilchrist. Do I have a second of that? A second of my Councillor. Any other nominations? No. So Phil, you'll honestly thank you very much. I hope you, I'm sure we'll work well together. Can I ask you now to look at your agenda pack and look at the minutes of the meeting of the Health and the Earth and Utility Committee on the 19th of March, and ask those members, if any of them were here at the last meeting, if you can approve the accuracy of those. All right? Okay, thank you. And also, the draft minutes of the Joint Overview and Scrutiny Committee of the 18th of December. Members who were on that, happy to recognise those as accurate. Yes? The next item on the agenda, item 5, is we are about to have a joint health and scrutiny committee, which is a committee made up of members from Cheshire West and Cheshire and Wirral Council. It will consist of six members and is considerably balanced. The membership for this from this committee will be two Labour and one Conservative. But I have nominations. If you're not able to give them tonight, we'll take them as soon as you possibly can.
Our nominations are myself and Councillor Norbury.
My nomination, please. Okay, and the first meeting, I say the first meeting, but the meeting that's already programmed in is on Monday the 1st of July, I think at 6 o'clock here. I think also we agreed, as was the case in the last meeting, that members from Eastham are able to come along and speak in the meeting, and also I'll be attending, whether it's me or not, but if that's okay, everybody. Good. Right, item six on the agenda, you will have seen, this is an item that I requested, and I think most people have worked with me before know I'm not really keen on verbal reports to committee, like discussing them in writing. On this occasion, it's because of short notice, and I did request this, that I know there's a presentation to be given, but there's no written report for you. But we have got Paul Moore, who's the Director of Quality and Assurance, and he's going to talk to us about the outcome of the recent CQC inspection for Wirral University Teaching Hospital. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Councillor McLaughlin, for inviting me today. I wanted to start by saying how helpful it was to receive the CQC inspection and how important it is for members to look upon the findings in the context of both the inspection that took place in March 19, but also the inspection that took place in March and May 2018. I say that because there has been some improvement with some particularly intractable areas like team working and culture and staff morale within the university department, which was a key problem in the 2018 inspection that was something that we've been working on. So, we were encouraged by that, and also encouraged by the fact that the CQC identified a number of areas of outstanding practice, which I think for the emergency department was both a first and not expected. Having said that, there are a number of issues that were identified to us that we needed to tackle, and if I can, with the permission of the committee, just try and address some of the issues that I think will be of concern, and then if I can take questions, I'll be glad to help. I think the key thing that will be of concern to members will be the issue around the responsiveness to patients waiting for initial assessment and triage. And this was a combination of, there wasn't one single issue here, but a combination of very high levels of bed occupancy, very high demand from the department, and insufficient patient flow. And when those factors combine, your pressure point is inside the emergency department because people continue to come in and there's nowhere for people to go. And as people are assessed and placed, they are often put on a corridor area while they can be observed. And at the time of the CDC inspection in March, we were operating under those conditions. There were a small number of people on corridors, but they were waiting an unacceptably long period of time for what I would consider to be triage and initial assessment. And this had been identified, and it was something that we were working on as part of our original CQC plan. We haven't, at the time of the inspection, we haven't concluded all our actions in this area, so I'm not surprised by the finding, but also not happy with it either. It's not representative of good care. And I think that leads on to corridor care generally. This is a difficult one. It presents an operational dilemma for people because when you haven't got any beds for people to go into and people are coming through the door, where do you place people? And often the safest option is for people to be in and around the proximity of the emergency department within access to resuscitation facilities and staff should be here, as opposed to being squeezed in a space somewhere else in the hospital, which may not be appropriate. I'd be the first to acknowledge that this is less than satisfactory, but it sometimes represents the least risky alternative for the patient when you're in that situation. And this practice has been operational at the hospital for some time. It certainly predates my arrival. And it's a practice I have experienced elsewhere in other hospitals where they are also under pressure. And you use it for the shortest possible time because it is not good care. And everybody knows that. When the CDC arrived, I think Her Majesty's Chief Inspector of Hospitals, in his report, which you have had a chance to read, made it crystal clear, I think, in that report, that corridor care is not compliant care, not compliant with Regulations 9 or compliant with Regulation 12. And I found that profoundly helpful as a conclusion for him to reach, because it put to bed, once and for all, any idea that it was okay to continue operating in this way. And as upon receipt of the report, we took immediate and decisive action to cease the routine use of corridor care as far as we could. And we've done that by expanding the front door of the emergency department, opened something called the reverse cohort area, which is essentially a place where people can go that's not a corridor while they're waiting for assessment and admission. It's a better standard of care for people. But as you'll understand, again, that can quickly be exhausted when you're under enormous pressure. And so whilst I'd like to give a guarantee about the elimination of corridor care, I don't think any one of us could. And so I use my words carefully and give you assurance that it's in relation to the routine use of corridor care. If we were to experience what I would call a mass casualty incident, an accident on the motorway involving many people at the same time, a bus for example, or a surge in patients coming with pandemic disease, I cannot give an undertaking that we will not in those circumstances need to use corridors. But if we were using corridors, it would be on an exceptional basis. That's, in a way, it's a temporary solution to a problem that's much bigger than the emergency department. It's about the flow of patients in and out of the hospital and in and out of the hospital system that perhaps is the underlying area where we should be applying our focus. And I know that my colleagues in the organisation and also my colleagues in the wider system and commissioning group are working extremely hard to try and find a way forward on that, in anticipation of what could be a difficult winter. I also took from the report very clearly that the length of time that patients were waiting once they'd been assessed and initially reviewed by the emergency department staff, once they'd been referred to a specialist, it was taking far too long for the specialists to come and collect the patient or review the patient. I can only agree with what the CQC found. The length of time for some people was unacceptably high. When I explored that with colleagues, I got all sorts of different explanations, ranging from consultants being busy and not able to come, to not being aware or informed, or the issue not being escalated in good time. It doesn't matter to me what the reason is. It's not quick enough. And therefore, we are taking steps to review the standard operating procedures that govern the assessment of patients that are referred by their GP, which might involve, instead of going to the emergency department, going to a specialist assessment unit, like the surgical assessment unit or others. And a standard operating procedure that governs the referral of the patient to are seen by the emergency department and then transferred to a specialist from within the department. As part of those procedures, it will be really clear what the escalation mechanisms need to be, right up to consultant-to-consultant discussion, so that delays can be avoided. We're not entirely happy with one of the findings that the CQC made, and that was in relation to the paediatric staffing levels. They requested that we look at this in light of a document known as the Intercollegiate Guidelines for the Royal College of Physicians. Now, the practice that we were operating in the organisation was that when the paediatric assessment unit was closed, paediatrician and paediatric nurses from the Women's and Children's Unit here. And this was a practice that has served us well over a long period of time and has certainly operational in many organisations that I've worked in. The intercollegiate guidelines, I'm surprised that the CQC have used them to inspect our services because I'm not sure in my mind that they have been accepted by the NHS as guidance that we must follow. I say that because what they're requesting might not be achievable. They're asking that we should have on duty at all times at least two registered sick children's nurses in the emergency department. If every emergency department were to carry out that request, there simply will not be enough registered sick children's nurses in the country to fulfil that objective. And we have about 8.5 children who come in overnight, and therefore the cost of doing that might be disproportionate to the risk. And so I have accepted the recommendation to review this, and I will review it. But I've also asked my colleagues at NHS England and NHS Improvement to look at the governance of what's in place for guidelines that are produced by some of these non-government organisations so that we can be sure when we're inspected against them that they are the guidelines that the commissioners and NHS England expect us to be implementing. I think it's an important point of principle that we should get clarification on, but I'm not dismissing the fact that we will still try and meet the requirements of the CQC on that issue. And then finally, I think you will want to be reassured around the infection prevention. The CQC were critical of the control of infection, and you will know, having scrutinised the organisation, that we have been dealing with an outbreak of Clostridium difficile infection. The strain of Clostridium difficile that we have circulating in the community and in the hospital is known as 027. And you don't need to know the details of it other than to know it's a very difficult infection to eradicate using standard procedures. And so it takes time. And we are making progress on this, but we are still experiencing patients acquiring Clostridium difficile infections. And so we're doing everything that we can to strengthen our arrangements, particularly around environmental cleaning, which is not as easy as it sounds given the condition of the building in some parts of the hospital. We're also strengthening arrangements around hand hygiene and dress code policies and procedures, and making absolutely sure that we have the best possible antimicrobial stewardship, which essentially means we are only using antibiotics when it is absolutely necessary to do so, because if they're not used correctly, it can cause problems for patients. I pause there, if I may, Chairman, to give your members an opportunity to comment. I will address everything, but I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, and I will open
such
questions in a moment. There's just a couple of areas I would like to question about clarification. The results of your vote area, I have heard about this. Could you just give me some idea of how many people it can accommodate at a time, how long you would expect them to stay in there, and are there specifically designated staff to look after those patients? That's one area. And the other area I would like you to address, if you didn't, is the report was quite critical of the leadership style.
Leadership style.
Yes, that was particularly mentioned, I think. So could you just clarify those and then I'll go to show
you. Okay, so in terms of the cohort area, my understanding is it can accommodate 12 people on trolleys.
On trolleys?
On trolleys, yeah. As they would in an emergency department queue, same trolleys. We regard the reverse cohort area as a temporary arrangement until we can get patient flowing, and therefore we don't need it. So we're managing on a temporary workforce, which is largely being staffed by representatives from all our divisions, including the core. So the triage target ought to be within 15 minutes. And since we have put these measures in place, we have managed to achieve an average triage time of less than 15 minutes. I asked my colleagues a few days ago what is the maximum time since we implemented these changes that someone has waited for triage, and that was 23 minutes. So I would say that that's a big improvement. Just remind me of your second question, if I can.
You said the time taking specialists to come back and collect patients, you described that as unacceptable.
Yeah, again, I think I don't have specific data, forgive me, I can't give you a specific figure on that, but we would be anticipating that no patient waits more than 12 hours in the emergency department before they are transferred to intensive care.
Sorry, so in terms of the tracking towards
the
15 minutes, obviously that sounds positive. So 15 minutes and 12 hour targets, next time this comes back, can we see how you're progressing?
Of course, absolutely.
Mr. Moore, thank you for your verbal report. I would also add that I share the Chair's concern about verbal reports.
Can I just clarify? Because I asked for two notices to go to verbal reports.
But having said that, I'm sure that this won't occur again. My question for you is what in that report was unexpected for you?
Well, you're talking to someone who is an expert in CPC compliance, so I suppose what was unexpected for me was the findings that there were outstanding pockets of outstanding practice. I didn't anticipate that. I knew when we were being inspected that it would be a report where the CPC inspectors would be critical of the patients being cared for on corridors. The biggest surprise for me was the finding that when asked, our staff did not seem to be able to demonstrate to CQC what to do in the event of a fire. And I found that quite shocking, because 97% of the staff who work in the emergency department are fire trained and have had their mandatory training every year. But they seem unable to persuade CQC. I found that was quite surprising. So when I went and had a look, I spoke to people, I would say that there was some uncertainty there, particularly in the people knew what the alarm sounded like, and they knew that there's two types of alarm. So one is like an earthquake alarm, and the other one is to make you aware there might be an issue. So people knew that. But what they were less sure about is where the rendezvous points were, so the evacuation points. And that was a surprise to me. Didn't expect that.
On that one,
very
briefly, what have you done about that since?
Oh, well, we have much more than the annoyance of our staff. We have made sure that every single member of staff is going through a retraining program so that they can be under no doubt where the rendezvous points are and what to do in the event of fire. It is interesting that as we were doing that, a few weeks after the report was circulated, the fire alarm went off in the radiology unit, which, if you know the ED, was next door. And I thought, I'm just going to watch and see what people do. Now, people did what we expected them to do, even though they might not have said it to the CQC. They all evacuated in an orderly manner. They went to the rendezvous viewpoint out in front of our apart hospital. They didn't return until they were given clearance to do so. So they did everything right. They just didn't say that to the CQC.
Anybody else want to ask a question? Yes,
Councillor
Gilchrist and Sharon.
Obviously, I've sort of fought my way through the 30 pages of the report at various times and tried to digest the picture. I think it's fair to say that there are some very good points in the report. I look at page 10. Staff demonstrated resilience and compassion when trying to help patients who experience significant delays and express frustration. If I take some of the other interesting quotes, page 18. Julie Doctor spoke positively about working in the emergency department. They told us consultants were supportive and was accessible and felt opportunities for learning were accessible. And I think page 22, as we'll let one out, there we go, find it again. Doctors described a significant improvement in their relationship with the Trust Board and senior management team in the previous 12 months. Later on, we observed a good working relationship between the ED team and paramedics. Staff in the ACU, and look at the other side, which is troubling me. Staff in the ACU and the acute medical unit said that they felt pressured to take patients they did not feel could be safely cared for there. Staff in the ACU and AMU said they were feeling demoralised from months of persistent pressure and working beyond capacity, but said support from the senior nurses and matron was excellent. And there was a particular section that perhaps you'd like to comment on. Although overall staff felt happier and more positive about working for the Trust, staff we spoke to within EDIU felt this did not apply to them. They described persistent challenging working conditions and a lack of communication with the senior team. So, one of the mixed points, and I'm clear that they've got views of staff pulling their guts out in a high-pressure situation, doing the best to treat people with compassion and respect. There appear to be glitches, one of which is the relationship with the walk-in part, the different management in walk-in and the section in the main hospital. Those seem to be points that need to be worked on. What is happening about all those things?
You raise a lot of important things there, and I think just I'm grateful that you highlighted the positives of people that said. But I also recognise that, you know, the teams are working under enormous pressure, and for them this pressure is unrelenting. It's day in, it's day out, it's non-stop. And I think they do a remarkable job in extremely difficult circumstances. And it's not easy for them. What they are experiencing is a symptom of a much bigger problem, and the problem, as I understand it, is it's discharging. We've got too many people in beds that we can't move on, and there are too many people spending too long in hospital, and that's the fundamental problem. Now, that manifests itself in congestion in ED and the ambulatory care unit and other areas where that pressure builds up. So the solution, although one might think, the solution is to go in and solve ED out, bedroom out, and ambulatory care unit out. Actually, the most important thing that can be done is to enhance the number and timeliness of discharges of patients, number one. Number two is to do what we can to avoid people from being admitted in the first place. And those two things will ease the pressure in the system, and I think that will dramatically enhance the satisfaction for staff and then being able to care. There is a complexity around what's known as streaming between the walk-in centre and the emergency department. And I know that my colleagues with the Community Trust and the Clinical Commissioning Group, they are exploring options that might help us to enhance the governance around the streaming system. And I know that those conversations are ongoing at the moment. I don't have an indication of what the conclusion might be to those discussions at the moment, but they're taking place now.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Can I ask if you can be quite succinct in putting the questions? Well, not particularly Sharon, but I'm conscious that we've got, I might say, not particularly Sharon, but I'm very conscious we've got a big agenda and I'd like to get as many people included. So I've got Sharon and then Mary and then Tony.
Thank you, Chair. My question was with regards to the infection prevention and control. Your new verbal report stated that the condition of the building was preventing you from maintaining an adequate level there. Can you tell me what's being done to mitigate that, please?
Okay. So first of all, you need to understand what I mean when I talk about the condition of the building. So we've got different types of flooring in different areas. We have wooden blocks screwed into the floor, which make it difficult to decontaminate because there's spores of C. diff and things just get soaked into the wood, you can't clean it. We've got some areas where, you know, the flooring surface, how it comes up against the walls, it needs to be welded against the wall in order to be cleaned properly. And in some places that welding has come away, so it's almost impossible to clean. Some of the wards and departments have shower units that are, have got mould in the silicone sealant, again, which is difficult to clean. We are having an all-out campaign right now on infection prevention. This cannot continue. And in addition to the things I've mentioned before, we're reviewing the cleaning schedules. We're having the states go around every area and identify the defects that need to be put right. We're reviewing our capital expenditure budget so that we can prioritise infection prevention interventions that make it easier, so we can do the showers refurbishments. We've got two wards in particular that experience more C. diff than anyone else, and that's Ward 38 and Ward 18. And those two wards are being completely redeveloped so that we can make them, we can standardise them first of all, and then make them exemplar sites. And then evaluate whether that makes an impact on the incidence of infection. And if it does, we then intend to roll that out to every other ward so that they can do the same. We're also with we're fantastically equipped with IT equipment. You know, we're one of the most, I think, fortunate organisations to have the IT equipment that we've got. But we also have iPads, computers, and all kinds of devices on wheels that we didn't have 40 years ago when the buildings were made. And these are big, bulky items, and they're usually squashed into the wards and put somewhere in a ward, which means there's no room for other storage, and so that finds its way out into the corridor areas. And then over the years, people have introduced trolleys and things, so you don't have to walk very far to get your equipment. But these things gather dust, and they're very difficult to clean. They're called bay buddies. We're going to have to get rid of all that. We're going to have to declutter as much as we possibly can. We're going to have to tackle uniforms. We're going to have to tackle hand hygiene and hold people to account when they're not complying with hand hygiene. And declare war on bacteria and cross-cutting the essential thing to do.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Mary.
Mary
Jane.
Thank you.
Mary Jane, you've answered my question partly. My question was around the other end, really. People who are stuck in beds and people who shouldn't be in hospital in the first place, because it's actually the worst place to be, isn't it? Because what we're looking at is infections, and the whole thing is self-perpetuating. You said you are starting to address it. What are you actually doing that will address that situation and improve patient flow?
Okay, so I'm sorry, Councillor, I've got your surname.
Jordan.
Councillor Jordan, thank you for the question. People have been working on this agenda for a very long time in the world. I'm not sure I can answer your question in the fullest sense, because I would need to consult my Chief Operating Officer and others just to give you a full answer, and I'm prepared to do that on my next visit. But I know that we are taking steps to scrutinise and examine what's known as stranded patients, and that might not be a nice term, but it essentially refers to people who've been waiting for an extended period of time. I know that those conversations are taking place with hospital practitioners and community practitioners, social care, general practitioners and others who would be involved in the multidisciplinary care of that patient. My understanding is that they are exploring all possible options to expedite a discharge as fast as possible and try and iron out what's holding up the discharge. In addition to that, we're trying to encourage our own consultants to focus more on discharge, so that we are thinking about the expected discharge date on the day of arrival rather than it being a secondary consideration, and optimising the care so that we work towards that goal. Be fair to say that as an organisation, the Trust as a whole is learning how to do that, to master that skill, so that we think mission avoidance in the first instance, then home first in the second instance. And when we're not able to do that, rapid assessment so that we can get the patient out as quickly as possible. But I should add that as an organisation, we have a very high number of people who are stranded.
Okay.
Councillor
Norbury?
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to ask a question regarding the staffing of, you know, the patients who are in the corridors and the knock on the house for the ambulance service.
Yeah, that's a good question. So when the patients were in the corridors, Wirral University Hospital had, I think it was the worst ambulance turnaround times in the Northwest, and it was labelled as part of the Super Six, which is an unhelpful term, but it basically meant the sixth lowest performance for ambulance turnaround times. And ambulance crews were left on the corridors looking after people for a very long period of time. I think that's been well publicised. Since we've made these changes, we have gone from the worst to the best in the Northwest. Now, I wish I could give you the figures, but I don't have them with me. But if the Chief Operating Officer were here, he would be describing to you a phenomenal turnaround in that we've managed to release crews much quicker. We don't hold on to crews now that we have the reverse cohort area, so they can be back on the road attending to patients. So I think we've gone from one of the worst to one of the best within the space of about 2 months. I'm happy to furnish you with details after the meeting if that would assist.
Thanks,
Chair. Mr. Moore, you describe yourself as an expert in CQC compliance, and yet you tell us that you were unaware until this report that routine care of patients in corridors was not compliant with regulations 9 or 12. Why is that the case? Is that because they've never found that before, or you didn't know?
I think there has been a change in the approach to corridor care among CQCs. There are many other organisations that are using corridor care that did not get a criticism by the CQC. So there's been a change in the CQC's thinking on this.
So, sorry, just follow on from that, Chair. So there's been no criticism of any other institutions prior to this report in relation to care in corridors, as far as you're aware?
To my knowledge, not prior to this report, but subsequent to it, there have been a number of other organisations that have been criticised by CQC as well.
Okay, thanks
so
much,
Chrissy.
I'm going to move on now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The recommendation, of course, is that we know this, and I'm also going to ask you that we ask for a further report as to be brought on your improvement plan, which I'm assuming you're going to develop. And we bring that to the appropriate committee for the health and care panel. Okay, so thank you very much. Next item on the agenda, item 7, is a report, annual report for Rural Evolutions. And I believe we've got Jean Stevens, who is the managing director of Rural Evolutions, and Mike Naden, I hope I've pronounced your name correctly, who's the chair. And you're going to introduce the report. We will have a presentation, I think, is online. Is to see. Members?
Good evening. First of all, thank you for the invitation here tonight. Just as a very brief background. Rural Evolutions Limited. We're a local authority trading company. We're 100% owned by Wirral Council. We're commissioned for services by Wirral Council, provide services for adults with disabilities. As a limited company, we have a board. We have four non-executive directors and one managing director. The company reports performance to the Wirral Council shareholder board, and we have six centres, a park, farm, and some specialised cafeteria. Our company went through some initial challenge when we set up. I'm now pleased to say that we're in good shape and we're pleased to be here. So, Mike Naden, I'm the chair of the organisation, and I have Gene Stevens with me, who's the managing director.
Just a little bit about me as an individual. I'm new in post, I've been in post as managing director for 4 months, but prior to that, I was the chief exec of Merseyside Sports Partnership, which works across the city region, advocating the benefits of being physically active and the improvements have on your physical and mental health. So that's just a little bit about it. The report that you've got in front of you is an opportunity for us to share our priorities for the next 12 months. And I'll talk members through the report step by step, and feel free to ask any questions at the end if that's okay. The purpose of the report was to give you an update on our priorities and the future direction of Rural Evolutions. But I want to stress partnership working with the people we support, families, carers, stakeholders and the communities. And our business operates in an efficient and effective manner, raising standards. We also stress around strong governance standards and principles at the highest level. And we've worked collaboratively to underpin Wirral Council's 2020-2030 pledge and healthy Wirral plan in our strategic framework. So where do we want that? Where are we now? Since being in post, I've helped support and led the development of a strategic framework for the next 5 years, which puts the people that we support at heart, which is very much about outcomes. And there's 5 outcomes that we're working towards, and it's lives in range, which looks at the mental and physical health of the person that we support. Looking at well-being, looking at the enjoyment, self-esteem, happiness, feel-good and friendship for the people that we support. Developing the individual themselves, looking at confidence, improving the choice available, exercising control, resilience, and those life skills along that journey of independency. And integrating into the community, whether that's into volunteering, other activities outside of our service, employment, training, education, promoting that social connectivity. That's what we're striving to in terms of positive outcomes, in terms of our strategic vision for the people that we support. How we do that and where we want to be is going to be through some key strategic outcome objectives. In terms of the people, we want to provide high quality provision to all the people that we support, to supply qualified and motivated workforce, to embed a culture of volunteering, reward and recognition, and to deliver opportunities to widen horizons for the people that we support, and to be the provider of choice in Wirral, and to have strong partnerships aligned to our company's vision, mission and values, which are on the previous page of your report. In terms of how we get in there, we've developed a comprehensive balanced scorecard which will monitor and provide both qualitative and quantitative metrics to show the success against the inputs and outcomes around the people that we support. And what we've done is we've looked at the people themselves, looking at having, making sure that their personal plans that are in place